for coming back again, Angie, and Sally as well. So, this is going to be a very interesting conversation. We had someone from the audience to ask about sustainability, and this is the platform for us to discuss how Cruises and the complete cruise family has been doing to uphold sustainability and environment protection. So, so let's get down to this. Maybe we can, I can start with you, Sally. One of the cruise lines' international association's priority policies is environmental stewardship. On your website, it's a 4-minute-long video that provides some very interesting information on the extent of work these companies have been doing in that aspect to minimize and conserve their, whether to conserve the environment and to minimize their impact on the environment. So, can you talk more about, or tell the audience more about this effort by the cruise companies?
So, just 2 weeks ago, here this evening, the first annual, we call the Global Cruise Industry Environmental Practices as well as Technologies Report. So, it sounds like a handful, but essentially the report compiles all the efforts that our cruise line partners have done. Actually, every cruise line, most of the cruise line partners have their own sustainability effort, their own sustainability report. What we're doing is we combine together just to have a holistic view of the cruise industry. So from the report, what is highlighted is that the cruise lines have invested more than $22 billion in new ships for the technology to in terms of using better environmental practices as well as cleaner fuels. Mm-hmm. So a lot of this focus in terms of, if you look at it in terms of the technology, some of the key highlights would be using LNG fuel, which is the cleanest form of fossil fuel, as well as the things that we do in terms of advanced use of equipment. So there's really a lot of effort that the cruise line does, and we are really investing a lot of money into it. And some of just the money, I think a lot of focus is also on internal processes. So the cruise lines also invest a lot in terms of making sure that the processes they have they also do spend a lot of thousands of man hours to clean their crew. So I think that is important as well, because beyond the technology, this is also the human part of it. You need to also educate and raise the awareness and interest of the crew.
Okay. Are you able to identify certain cline findings from a most recent study that are clear improvement on the last study, for example?
So, for example, like I mentioned, the LNG fuel, so that's really the cleanest fuel. So, we're seeing that more new ships are using, moving towards using fully LNG fuel to fuel the ships. There's also efforts in terms of, for example, using solar power. So, when the ships are in dock, if let's say the port can support it, the ships are able to tap the power from the port. Then that will actually reduce the need for the engine to be kept running to keep the ships going. So these are just some of the examples. But generally, across the board, of course, cruise lines are doing things also like banning the use of single-use plastics. They also do a lot of recycling efforts. In fact, a lot of them tend to reuse a lot of the materials such that they are working towards zero waste.
Zero waste.
So that you don't use everything that you have in work and reducing the
So just for information, I pulled up some stats from the last 4-minute video, which is of course by now is outdated because it's got new information. But just based on that, cruise lines in general recycle 60% more waste per passenger than the average person does on land. And $1 billion has been invested in new emissions technology and cleaner fuels to further protect air quality. More than $8 billion has been invested in developing LNG fuel ships that give off lower emissions and have higher energy efficiency. So there's a lot of money being spent on that. So Andrew, tell me, from the company's perspective, what has Royal Caribbean been doing this space?
Well, it's a heavy topic to talk about after that, isn't it? But I would like to pose a question to the audience. And just by show of hands, the corporate clients that you're working with today, is environmental sustainability a consideration in terms of a destination or a location in which you're choosing your event?
If
so that there's one person in the audience. Well, I can tell you at Royal Caribbean, our entire company, it is a leading principle to be an environmentally sustainable global citizen of the world. And this is not because of recent headlines, because that brings a lot of drama and attention to it, but it's because it's the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. And over 30 years ago, Royal Caribbean created our own Save the Waves program before sustainability became a hot topic. So it's not something that's just risen today. It's who we are, and it's who we are in our DNA. And so, and in the last 5 years, in 2016, we partnered with the World Wildlife Foundation. Mm-hmm. They're leaders in the sustainability and environmental standards. And we work with them on very transparent and measurable goals that are published annually. So this isn't something about, yes, the buzzword is we're removing plastic straws, right? That's what every hotel and a lot of cruise lines and restaurants are saying to, you know, put themselves in the umbrella of being a good environmental steward. Of course we're doing that, but it goes way beyond that, and there's the measurable standards. So, for example, in 2016, we made a commitment that we would reduce our carbon emissions by 30% by the year 2020. I'm happy to report that we've already done that. Amazing. We've done that this year. And it's not an easy task, and it's not a cheap task, because as Jolly says, the cruise industry is spending billions on research and development to make sure that our ships are going to be the ships of the future, zero waste, that's what we're working for. And our goals that we've published with the WWF come to fruition in 2020. We're on target to have more sustainable tours in the destinations that we visit. We are on target to have more sustainable procurement of the food that we source. And so it goes beyond just the fuel that we're burning, but it's in every aspect that we can contribute into the environment, the destination, and sustainability. Because it truly is a part of who we are, because we operate in the oceans. And so if we can't take care of the environment, then we don't have a business or a foundation in which we can run our business.
Since we're already talking about the efforts that you're putting in, can we talk a bit about over-tourism? I mean, you tackled that very densely just now. Are there specific processes in place for the company to reduce or to cancel out the effects of over-tourism?
Well, I think over-tourism, again, is another word that we hear a lot, and I think it could be better defined as mismanaged tourism. I believe that a lot of destinations have just enjoyed the influx of tourism, not only from the cruise industry, but from other channels. And so I think we just have to be better, more mindful and better planning at planning in the destinations that we want to visit. So as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of destinations that our guests are interested in visiting, but until we have sustainable destination experience, we don't want to bring them there because, again, we want to be good citizens to the destinations that we're visiting. So Royal Caribbean created a joint venture with a company that is an expert in destination development. The company name is called Holistica. The joint venture is Holistica. And the name really summarized what the intent of the program is to take a holistic approach to planning tourism. And so we're doing it because we got tired of waiting for the destinations to think about how to develop a sustainable experience. And so we've taken it upon ourselves to develop the experience we want to create in the destination. But we're not doing it just for us. We're doing it with all stakeholders, airlines, hotels, the government, immigration, so that we have a holistic approach to how we want to activate tourism in the destinations that we visit. And so I think that's kind of the future of where we need to go, to be smarter and plan about it, and really think long-term about the future and the health of the places that we're going.
Can you name a destination that is part of the project with Holistica?
Well, the first project is very focused in the Caribbean, in the Bahamas, actually. And if you follow the global news, you know the Bahamas got hit pretty hard with a natural disaster of hurricanes. And again, Royal Caribbean has been a key leader in helping sustain and bring those Bahamas destinations. Kind of, they have a long way to go, but we are investing in the Bahamas in the infrastructure. So we're partnering with the hotels the government, airlines within the Caribbean, and that's our first focus, but it will be a global focus.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Sally, do you have any examples of other cruise members who have also invested this much and specific examples in managing or better manage tourism?
So, here on behalf of our cruise line, actually, we signed an MOU with the City of Dubai, and the idea is to support their efforts in terms of sustainability and tourism.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, it's something that we actually work with destinations on, and it's really coming up with like the framework as well as working here on behalf of the cruise industry, and then the government on behalf of their destination partners.
Mm-hmm.
We see a very strong private and public kind of partnership where it's really an effort that it has to come from everybody. It's not something that, single-handedly, the cruise line can do something about helping a destination, but really working hand in hand together. And this is where, in a step in the right direction, where there is like a council talking together and the effort on how things can be done in terms of the cruise industry is always more than happy to look and work together with the destination.
Okay, great. Well, clearly the cruise companies have been doing all that to save the environment, to conserve the environment. So why do you think cruise companies are often being accused of inaction or not doing enough by various non-government organizations?
Well, I think it's we're in business to sell holidays, so it's not very fun or exciting to talk about what you're doing to recycle your waste on board. And the fact that we're recycling the steam from our diesel engines to heat the hot water to use our laundry. I mean, that's just, there's a lot more fun to talk about slow riding and skydiving and bumper cars and entertainment. So I think we just haven't spent a lot of time talking about it, which is one of the reasons I was excited to be here with you today. We're not perfect and we have a long way to go, but it's a journey of continuous improvement and it's an important one. And I think it's about letting the communities know that we are focused on this, and especially at Royal Caribbean, it's a number one priority in our organization.
Mm-hmm.
Every one of our ships have an environmental officer on board. You would be amazed at what is done on board these floating cities. On Royal Caribbean, we have state-of-the-art recycling centers. 75% of our waste will never reach a landfill. We have balers, pressers, sorters. We treat our wastewater so that we release nothing in the ocean, ever. It's just not acceptable. And in fact, the water that we clean is oftentimes cleaner than city drinking water before we rid of it. So it's quite amazing, just some of the simple things. Can you imagine that you can save electricity by not toasting your toast for so long? So instead of extra crispy toast, have a little less crispy toast. When you add that up to the number of people sailing on cruise ships, you can actually save real energy doing it. So we're at that level of thinking in terms of how we can be smarter about the environment and energy.
And I think the key thing is when cruise ships are getting larger and larger, and then the ship drops in the destination, it just appears like there's a lot of people coming on board. But let me put into perspective of in terms of the numbers. So if you add together all the cabins globally and all the cruise ships and compare it to the hotels, the actual cruise only has 2% of the global hotel rooms. Then you look at the number of ships in terms of commercial cities. Cruise ships, we have about 400 cruise ships right now. It's actually less than 1% of all commercial shippings out there. So the percentage is really, really small. We are very, very small. But even for the travel industry, if you look at the number of cruise passengers, we are only like 2% of all international travelers. But the focus is still on cruise because it's very visible. And when the ship comes, then people will have the impression that actually cruise brings a lot of people and problems to this. But then you look in the context of the entire industry, because the cruise is a really small part.
Mm-hmm.
But regardless of that, again, we don't see it as that, we're just a very small player, and we shouldn't do anything. We are constantly looking at solving the problem. We're not looking at whether we are the problem or not, but we are trying to make sure that the cruise industry moves forward. And I see the cruise industry is always a leading player in terms of the American industry.
the cruise ships are always in terms of leading, but in terms of the technology.
So Andy mentioned a point about how cruise companies are not doing that. He talked about the good things that they're doing besides the fun stuff. From an association point of view, could the association take the lead in telling that good story, that sustainable story?
So, I believe that's where the effort in terms of putting together the information, compiling it into easily understood. It's actually quite technical, like they say, it's not really very sexy to talk about the fuels and the waste water. Yeah, but it's we see it increasingly very important, especially with the consumers getting more interested in such information. So, we have been actively also going out to our travel trade partners. Because they are the front to the consumer, because if they need to be as well equipped with the information as well, because if not, the consumers will not, when they ask the person to the travel industry, when they don't know what's happening. So we have a lot of information on our website, we have a lot of toolkits, and we constantly go out to our travel partners to say that, you know, now at this moment, maybe no one is asking you about sustainability, but the next moment, they will turn around and ask you, and you should be at the front facing of the industry. You really need to be equipped with the information.
Okay. Do you think that it would help with the sustainability conversation if there were global environmental standards against which cruise companies' efforts could be measured? Possibly environmental standards that all companies that have to adhere to, not just cruise companies, but at least you can compare, you know, what the
cruise
companies are doing, what the
hotels
are doing, what the corporate organizations are doing. Are there standards like that?
So right now, more on a more technical front, of course, there is the maintenance and IMO standards. But if you're talking about a set of cruise-specific standards, I think increasingly, I think in the environmental world, they're trying to reduce the number of new standards because it becomes very confusing for the consumers. And I think there is this issue of greenwashing, and people tend to just, you know, brush issue and try to make it sound like it's more important than it should be. So I think the key thing, and players like Royal Caribbean is working with established organizations, people who are experts, like the World Wildlife Fund, yes, the Global Sustainability Tourism Council. So these are, you know, they are experts in the field, they are the leading credible source, and they are independent. So that's really very important as well, because you don't want to set a standard and then you tell people that, oh, this is an important standard, but are you really the independent person to really certify yourself? So working with these partners is actually more effective and more sustainable, and I think that's what the key funds are doing. They are working with these key partners, with UN, and it's just trying to get, and what instead of this you're doing is more of a comparison. So everywhere it has to get better, so there are like events coming in terms of presenting. So last year they did this year they've done it better, they work to present it, and I think that is actually what is more important.
Yeah. And you have worked with the projects with our sister and other partners as well, and WWF. How are you taking that story out to the public?
Well, again, it's not something that we've notably talked about. It's just something that we do. It's even like our charitable donations that we make and the work that we're doing in a lot of the destinations that we visit. It's not something that we want to talk about because we don't want to seem like we're bragging. But I think with the environmental standards, it is something that we publish on our site for those that are passionate and want to learn more. But I think talking about it in this way, as consumers are starting to pay more attention, and directing their dollars towards brands who are becoming environmentally friendly and sustainable in whatever business that they're operating in. But I think the context is right. It's, you know, the cruise industry is actually a small percent of the global situation, but it's not going to stop us from knowing it's the right thing to do. And at Royal Caribbean, we always operate what we call above and beyond compliance. And so we tend to research the globe. What are the strictest, highest level of requirements? And then we always try to work above that. Because our ships operate all over the world, and they'll move all over the world. And so, you know, we can't build a ship and process and programs to satisfy only Singapore, and then we move that ship to Europe or to Alaska. So we look across the world. Right now, Europe probably has some of the strictest standards. And then we adhere to the highest of that, and oftentimes above that. Because again, it's just the right thing to do.
happens in the cases where companies or organizations that are not in the cruise industry, and they look at the kind of work that the companies have been doing, and they use that as a benchmark or a case study to adopt in their own organizations. Have you come across examples like that?
Exactly, but I think again, bringing it back to the destination context. So we do work with destinations and then try to help the destination. So the cruise ship calls in many places globally, and a lot of times the cruise ship might call at somewhere where you know they would like to learn as a case study and even in selling. So cruise being a very global kind of organization, we have been able to take a case study from a global region and then how we can develop a destination in a more sustainable manner. So I think that is one of the areas that the cruise being a globalized type of context has helped. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where we see a lot more questions from, like they ask, but also if you want to develop our destination, what is the really doing, and then we bring the context from a case study from another place, but with similar type of challenges or similar type of
I'm going to open the floor for questions. Any questions? Yes. The mic runner.
Good afternoon, panel and delegates. My name is Eric Sumaya. I come from Langkawi. I'm a tour operator as well as very much engaged with the environment, with the Malaysian Nature Society. So I've got a lot of relevant questions that I've been asked. Maybe you could, either it can be answered or it can be taken as a guideline for you to improve further. Number one on cruise ships. The ships are getting bigger and bigger from time to time, evolving to bigger quantities. I remember in about 15 years ago, I was with my clients of tourism and life, nice 15 beach, having a nice lunch set up on the beach over the sea, and far about 10 kilometers away, a big cruise ship was passing through. So we were waiting at them and it was very nice. And about 15 years later, a big wave came up and took away all of my passengers, lucky they swam back, and all of the lunch away. So that made me thinking that the displacement of water of the waves of the cruise ship are so extensive that nobody is really talking about it. And then I started thinking about what will happen to all these 15 little islands around Langkawi, Phuket, and many places around the world where cruise ships are basically going, how much of destruction, degradation of the corals, of the islands, is actually happening, but nobody is looking under the sea or what is happening, but nobody lives in these places. So I think it is very important that we, in tourism, because tourism for me is the biggest destruction of the environment, anywhere you put into the entire world, but how we can be sustainably be aware of the deviation that we do and how we can able to manage it sustainably. Thank you.
Okay, so you're talking about the displacement of water affecting the call for the destination that you previously spoke to. Is that a question that you're able to tackle? I mean, it's a very technical
question. We do have our marine and environmental experts. So whenever we look at going into a destination, We have our marine team that come in to evaluate the destination, but we do that in partnership with the government. And before we do any kind of building or approval of bringing in larger ships, there has to be an environmental study done, of which the government has approved in terms of findings to allow the ship to come, and also that we feel good about it as well. But I think the water displacement is a technical question that I don't personally have the answer to, but I'm sure we can find the answer to consider that. Mm-hmm.
as well as you sustainably manage the vessel. Because once the vessel is gone, then you nobody wants to come back there again. So
right.
The amount of rubbish, the amount of disposal is so extensive. Number two is, I'm very happy that you say you have this flooding of wastewater into the sea after fantastic treatment. I'm very proud that you do that. But how many of the species are doing that? This is something that you need to really look into very, very seriously, because the sea, the marine water, is so bad these days. It's got up to 12,500 ppm readings, which is supposed to be allowable readings of 100. So these are something that you need to really reconsider, and like how to say, everybody likes to frame a nice picture on the outside, okay? The reality is something else. So you should get real on this aspect.
Maybe I'd like to then, have you gone to see the cruise line report? So I think cruise line actually has their sustainability report. And once again, it's not something that they actively talk about, but every cruise line actually do their own effort. Of course, in different ways, not in all the same models. If we talk about the two largest, the Royal Caribbean as well as the Carnival Corporation, the two largest cruise companies, they all have efforts both covering all the technologies on the ship as well as the destination. So I think essentially, at least if I speak on behalf of my cruise members, everybody has to work together as an industry, which is why we have these reports that we come out, and every year we take time for them to talk about the improvements that have been done. Again, we're not saying that we're perfect. It's more about every year, consciously being aware. I think awareness is one of the key formats, and then working on it year-on-year. And of course, we always love the partnership with the destination as well. So going hand in hand, again, it's not just the cruise industry or the cruise partners. Everybody has to work together, and that's where, like I say, we are forming the partnership with the destination to support each other, and be part of the independence. It's also for example, the UN or the Global Sustainable Trading Council. So these are third-party independent parties who have a framework that we can reference to, and using that framework to kind of work together on the sustainability aspect.
Thank you.
One suggestion I have, I hope I'm not going to make a time, is on the displacement of water in the little island and how to get everything done, probably the international association or whatever it is could start creating a monitoring of this new island that the displacement of water going in, and at that area that they have a very strict guidance of how slow they can go so that the displacement of water is not very fast. The faster you go on the displacement of water, the greater the damage is. So that kind of control can be put in place. These are very practical areas which you don't need to pay a lot of money, you just have
I think that's really good advice. I would guess that on our marine team, they probably are doing that. And to your point of maybe not all governments are going to take the environment into consideration before approving your ship to come. Again, at Royal Caribbean, we also operate by our own standards. And as I've mentioned before, there's some destinations in Asia that our guests want to go to, and we simply are not going to take them until the destination is up to standard in terms of infrastructure, tourism, sustainability, and just making sure that we are leaving the destination in a better condition, same or better condition than when we arrived. And so we will decide whether or not we can go, also based on our own standards. But I think very valid concern on the water displacement, take it back to our industry experts, so thank you for that.
Thank you so much.
Oh, sorry. We don't have time for another, because the keynote lecture is going to start soon.
Just a short strategy, I think, if I may. Bawati gave a very good example, as you may have
noticed,
in the industry, that they shut down for us. So I think perhaps the cruise industry can also see where a destination is being run down from the degradation factor. Then maybe they can also try to shut down that destination for a certain period of time and try to find another destination.
enter that destination, place the breeders, and respect the human.
Again, I think that goes back to proper strategic management of tourism. Mm-hmm. And I think there's some places that have learned the hard way in terms of not having proper guidelines around the type of tourism they want to do and creating an infrastructure. It creates a win-win for the people that want to visit as well as the destination.
Well, I
sense
that this is a conversation that a lot of people want to talk about. So you can always revisit this topic. Yeah, thank you for having joining us today, Angie and Sally. Thank you so much.